afternoon at AFSA headquarters. We're delighted you're here. I'm Barbara Stevenson, and I'm the president of the American Foreign Service Association. You know, every once in a while we come across a book, and we feel that it is really strongly relevant to the Foreign Service. And when we can, we like to bring the authors of those books here to do a book notes evening so we can discuss it and interact with practitioners. And today's selection, Foreign Policy Breakthroughs, is absolutely one of those books. I'm really pleased because I've had the chance to meet and work with Bob and Ambassador Bob Hutchings, who's one of the two authors. We had also hoped to have his collaborator, Dr. Jeremi Suri, with us today, but illness has overtaken the Suri household, and he's had to stay on the home front in Texas and take care of his folks. But we are delighted that Bob is here in AFSA. We're going to get a chance to talk about the book. I'm also pleased to welcome today's moderator, Ambassador Barbara Bodine. You know, she's somebody that I looked up to the whole way I was coming through my career, I'll tell you that, and I do still today. Ambassador Bodine, who now heads the Institute for the Study of Diplomacy at Georgetown University, wrote an insightful review of Bob's book in the December issue of the Foreign Service Journal. So she was a natural choice for the moderator role today. So welcome, Barbara. So without any further ado, I am going to turn this over to Barbara Bodine and Ambassador Bob Hutchings. Thank you all for being here.
Okay,
sorry about this.
Is my mic working all right? Can you hear me in back? Fine, thanks. Well, it's a real pleasure to be here, and thank you very much, Barbara. It's a pleasure to be here, and thanks to all of you for coming. It's an audience I've really been looking forward to engaging with for quite a while. So did my co-editor, Jeremi Suri. He's really sorry he couldn't be here. I sort of hoped he'd be here for another reason. Is it loud enough back there?
Yes.
Okay. I'll try to speak a little louder.
Of course. You're loud, but I don't think the mic's working.
Okay.
I think your naval officer voice is coming through more than the mic.
Okay, is that better?
Yeah.
Great.
There we are.
Thanks. So, Jeremi and I have been working on this project, and actually, this book's an outgrowth of an even larger and more ambitious project that is sort of maybe overly ambitiously called Reinventing Diplomacy. I mean, obviously it didn't take the two of us to do this, but we, along with others, thought that the study of diplomacy had been neglected, both at the professional foreign service level and certainly at the universities. And I've spent roughly half my career in each of those two camps, almost exactly equally divided. So I've seen the deficiencies, the deficits on both sides. Jeremi, who has not been in public policy positions, is a really premier international historian, but one who takes a real interest in the lives of diplomats, the work of diplomats, and he's not one of those academics who looks with sort of contempt and disdain on those in government. He has great respect for those, even while criticizing some of the practices that we both saw. So we both came together after I was at that time dean of the LBJ School at the University of Texas. I recruited him away from the University of Wisconsin. As soon as he got on board at Texas, we created this project, and it resulted, I'll get to the book in a minute, I want to talk about some of the other activities. We launched new curriculum, so we created about five new courses, some undergraduate, some graduate, so that we can begin to develop something that can be called a curriculum in diplomacy, because such a curriculum rarely happens at American universities. We did some research projects, we've done some public outreach, and we created something that just met for the second time called the Austin Forum on Diplomacy and Statecraft. We just met the second time last month. We bring together in Austin in January for 3 days practicing diplomats from the United States, Europe, and Latin America, about two dozen of them, people at so around mid-career. Alicia Allison, who's in the office, was a participant last year. So it was sort of an Aspen-like experience to get people outside the Washington Beltway, outside the Brussels bubble, and in an environment where they can really have a strategic dialogue, not imprisoned by their talking points, sort of free to explore some ideas, totally off the record. And it's been a great success. So the book fits in that context. We decided early on we wanted to do a book of case studies because the case literature has really diminished, been depleted in recent years. I know Ambassador Barbara Bodine is working hard to correct that.
Yes.
At the Institute for the Study of Diplomacy, which houses the Pew case study series and is now being sort of revitalized. So our contribution was a series of more academic case studies. These are sort of deep dives. Those of you who picked up the book will see they are 9 case studies, mostly written by academics, a few by practitioners. And we wanted people who were truly expert on the cases in question. Almost all of those, the authors, have written books on the subject, which they then condensed into a chapter for this volume. And we wanted to do cases in successful diplomacy because almost everything is reveling in diplomatic failures. Academics in particular love to find failures and to point the finger at all the things that these feckless bureaucrats fail to do and how the world would be so much better off if only academics were running it. I'm not so sure that's the case. But anyway, we want to do things on successes because we thought we should learn from our successes as well as from our failures. So we gathered a group of scholars together who had contributed draft chapters. We discussed those chapters. And in an early conference, we unearthed a couple of themes that we invited the chapter writers to go back and incorporate in their writing. And one was a distinction between diplomatic success and successful diplomacy. The former is outcome-driven. If things turned out well, we label it success. If things turned out poorly, we label it failure. So the Bay of Pigs invasion was a failure because the U.S.-sponsored invasion failed and the invaders had to retreat back to the United States. The Cuban Missile Crisis was a success because the Soviets were obliged to remove their missiles without a nuclear exchange. Had the Bay of Pigs somehow succeeded, against all odds, Kennedy might have been credited for a great foreign policy success, because against long odds, against all the advice, he took the chance. And had the Cuban Missile Crisis ended in a U.S. nuclear exchange, U.S.-Soviet nuclear exchange, that might have well been labeled a failure, because Kennedy would have been accused of reckless behavior with a less than stable Soviet leader. So we were more interested in successful diplomacy, that is the quality of what diplomats did. So it really required a deep dive into their actual behavior, the behavior of actual human agents to cause change. This brought forth a second theme that ran throughout all the chapters, and that is what the political scientists call the distinction between structure and agency. The structure is simply the objective reality that statesmen and diplomats inherit. Sometimes the objective reality is so fraught that no amount of skillful diplomacy can bring about a breakthrough. ISIS strikes me as a case in point today. Other times, the forces are converging toward a happy outcome that even a diplomatic bungler could have seen through to success. We were interested in the cases in the broad middle, those where an opportunity for imaginative diplomacy presented themselves, and where diplomats acted skillfully to bring about those effects. So that's sort of where the book was. We have the 9 case studies. I will go through them very briefly just to highlight some of the interesting themes that came out of them. And I should say at the outset, cases range from epical events like the end of the Cold War to the convening of a single conference, the Bandung Conference of 1955. Some cases involved the United States, others didn't involve the United States at all. We deliberately wanted to have this variety of cases to see if we could draw some general lessons out of them. And we tried to be faithful to the cases themselves. We didn't impose a preconceived set of conclusions on chapter writers. We wanted them to do their own thing, and then we would pull out of their writing what seemed to be the enduring lessons. So the first case was a relatively neglected case called the creation of the United Nations Relief and Rehabilitation Administration at the end of World War II. The actual results of this effort were mixed, I think is the best you could say, but in terms of the diplomacy to pull it off, we label a case in successful diplomacy. A couple of things were noteworthy. One was the prior planning went into this. The British began stockpiling food supplies as early as 1940 in anticipation of post-war humanitarian and refugee crises that would need to be addressed. That degree of foresight is almost unimaginable. But the effort never could have gotten off the ground had the planning not started then. President Roosevelt created an office in the State Department 3 months before Pearl Harbor to do exactly the same thing, to prepare for what came next. And what happened was the largest multinational intergovernmental relief operation ever mounted. 44 countries, countless international organizations and non-governmental organizations delivering assistance. The other noteworthy thing about this case is learning from history. President Roosevelt and Prime Minister Churchill learned from the mistakes made in post-World War I relief in the Soviet Union, when the entire relief effort was mounted by the United States without the involvement of Soviet authorities, which set us off on a very negative course for the new Bolshevik regime. Learning from that mistake, the Roosevelt administration engaged the Soviet leadership from the very beginning. So the second case is the Bandung Conference of 1955. It's an interesting case in that this conference, although it didn't achieve much, it did mark the beginnings of what later became known as the Non-Aligned Movement, or the Third World, a term coined at the conference itself. And it brought together both fairly established, powerful leaders like Mao and Nehru with newly installed leaders of post-colonial states like Nasser and Sukarno. And they managed to gather in Bandung and articulate a worldview that was at odds with that of the First World, the United States and its Western allies, as well as the Second World, the Soviet Union and its allies. The third case is the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, and it's an important reminder. We're so riveted these days, appropriately so, on North Korea and Iran. It's worth recalling that there was a time in the Kennedy administration when it was widely assumed that there would be a proliferation of new nuclear powers, 20 to 25. What the Kennedy administration feared would happen. The negotiations took place over 7 years and resulted in the Non-Proliferation Treaty, which was signed in 1968 and went into effect in 1970. Some of you know this history better than I do, I'm sure, but this is the part of it that I know. Went into effect in 1970 and has held up for 45 years, with only four breakout states and only four new nuclear powers in all those years. So a spectacular success, made possible partly by a lesson that latter-day diplomats have applied to the negotiations with Iran, made possible by secrecy, because these negotiations were done over the course of many years in Geneva, outside the spotlight of public scrutiny. Had the negotiations been out in the glare of public scrutiny from the beginning, the deal never would have been struck. It required a degree of secrecy to enable to explore different options so that once a framework agreement had been agreed on in secret, then of course it went public. So I'll come back to that at the end, sort of the balance between secrecy and openness in a democratic society. The next case was my co-editor Jeremi Suri's chapter on the American opening to China in 1970, 1972, Kissinger, and of course, also the Chinese opening to the United States. One of those breakthroughs that no one anticipated, but once it occurred, everyone took for granted. Well, of course, you could adduce all the reasons that China had for making an arrangement with the United States and vice versa. A couple of things that I'll note about this case. One was the prior planning. This was on Nixon's agenda even before he assumed the presidency, and he began sending signals as soon as he became president through whatever channels he could find to China, simply saying, we want to have a conversation, we want to talk about exploring the relationship. And it took 2 years of signals that the Chinese were also sending. Some signals were missed, but eventually the breakthrough occurred. This was also done with secrecy for obvious reasons. Nixon, a Republican, would have faced huge opposition from his own party on the Hill, who were all still affected by the China lobby about who lost China. So Nixon had to be very careful. He sent Kissinger on a mission, a secret mission from Pakistan. Kissinger feigned an illness, said he came down with the flu, needed to go up to the mountains to recover, and from the mountains of Pakistan flew secretly to China to arrange the meeting. And then Nixon went, and here's something, having worked in the White House for 3.5 years, I find mind-boggling. Nixon went without an agenda, without a schedule. The briefing books I used to carry around with me, a single day of a president's agenda would be about that thick. He went without even an agreed meeting with Mao Zedong himself. It was a risk, but I'm not a big fan of Richard Nixon, but I came away from this chapter a bigger fan than I had been. Because at some level, Nixon understood history well enough to know that because of the unequal treaties, Chinese feelings of exploitation by the West, Chinese feelings of weakness in the face of the United States, he needed to be seen as a supplicant. He needed to put aside matters of national pride or self-righteousness and be seen as the supplicant going to China. And of course, Mao received that signal, understood the signal, and met with him, and then that achieved the breakthrough. The next chapter was the Camp David Accord. This was done by an Israeli scholar, so it was done from the perspective of Israel and Egypt rather than Jimmy Carter and the United States. The U.S. side of the story has been well told. This side of the story, not so well known. This is interesting in a number of respects. The one that struck me was the three parties to this agreement. Well, first of all, the agreement is held up for 45 years. So bad as things are in the Middle East, they would be even worse without an Egyptian-Israeli peace that has held up all these years through it all. One of the noteworthy things was the three parties to the agreement had opposing objectives. Jimmy Carter, for political reasons as well as personal religious convictions, wanted to create a Palestinian state. Menachem Begin, the Israeli prime minister, wanted to avoid the creation of a Palestinian state and thought a separate peace with Egypt was the best way of achieving that. And Anwar Sadat of Egypt didn't care about either of those things. He wanted to recover lost territory. So it's another lesson that sort of takes us forward to what's going on with the ramshackle coalition trying to contain ISIS. These are political actors who have quite opposing objectives, perspectives, national interests. It's an open question of whether there's enough commonality to come together to defeat or contain ISIS. The other thing that struck us about this case, was the use of creative ambiguity. There were some issues so fraught that they could not be agreed upon. The status of Jerusalem, the meaning of the occupied territories, the settlement, the accord, used language that was sufficiently vague that Menachem Begin could go back to Israel and spin the agreement in one way, and Anwar Sadat could go back to Egypt and spin it a different way, and both sides knew what the other was doing and was okay with that. Again, in terms of contemporary politics, we should understand that the Iranians have to go back to their own constituencies, whatever those stakeholders are, and spin the agreement in a certain way that we may find objectionable. And they should understand that President Obama has to come back and spin the agreement in a way that puts him in a favorable light. And both sides should allow that latitude on the other side in order to satisfy the domestic requirements of modern diplomacy. The next chapter is one I wrote on American diplomacy and the end of the Cold War in Europe. Ambassador Tony Wayne is in the back row. We were at the NSC together during this period, so I know this period pretty well. I won't say a whole lot about it, except to say that, like the opening to China, this is one of those events that no one saw coming. Few saw coming, maybe a handful. Certainly not as many as claimed to have seen it coming after the fact. Yet after it happened, it was simply taken for granted. And the role of diplomacy was devalued as if it just, quote, happened somehow. As I argue in the chapter, the Berlin Wall didn't fall. It was made of steel and concrete and could have lasted another 100 years. It was chipped away. The Iron Curtain didn't part. It was actually cut by human hands, beginning with those of Hungarian Foreign Minister Gyula Horn and his Austrian counterpart, Alois Mack, who actually clipped segments of the Iron Curtain. So a couple of points that come out of this chapter are prior planning. There wasn't the opportunity for the kind of prior planning that ideally might have happened. When I went to the NSC in March of 1989, there was no file drawer saying, in case of German unification, open file and follow directions. There was nothing to explain what to do to help the liberation of Eastern Europe, the self-liberation of Eastern Europe, and no file drawer saying what to do if the USSR disintegrates. We had to make this stuff up on the fly. It wasn't perfect, but there was some serious, concentrated, strategic thought going in. I'll just mention maybe the first strategic judgment that we reached in the spring of 1989. Some of you will remember the time of the Polish Roundtable Agreement, March-April 1989. The Polish regime agreed with the Solidarity Trade Union Movement to hold openly contested elections that summer. We concluded, that as a product of some considerable strategic analysis, that if these elections were held as promised, this was the beginning of the end of communism in Poland. If that was the case, this was the beginning of the end of communism everywhere in Eastern Europe, including East Germany, which meant that the German question had just leapt onto the international agenda. So we were doing contingency planning for the prospect of German unification already in the spring, 6 months before the Berlin Wall was breached. Another thing I'll just mention in this chapter is the quality of political leadership. I was sort of struck in this chapter, which I wrote, but on reflection, and in the other chapters, of the political leaders we studied were, for the most part, not charismatic personalities, Mao ones, maybe Sadat. But for the most part, they weren't charismatic figures. They weren't master strategists. They weren't gifted orators. They weren't commanding personalities. Yet, the leaders we studied still exercise leadership of a very high order. So it caused us to sort of drill a little deeper to see what the qualities of leadership were that made a difference in these cases. And in the case of the first president, Bush, it was a number of things. Emotional intelligence and stamina, deep knowledge of his own government, and an ability to put the right people in the right positions and to have a coherent government that had actors ranging from the top figures, Baker, Bush, and Scowcroft, down to all the hundreds, if not thousands, of diplomats and other foreign policy officials required to implement policy. Not a trait easily come by. The next chapter is by a British scholar who's actually living and teaching in Berlin on the evolution of the European Union. It's an interesting take because the textbook version of this is heroic European figures encouraged by the United States after World War II, Robert Schuman, many others, got together and had a vision for Europe which is no longer riven by wars. And of course that narrative is not untrue, but is a narrative. This tells a somewhat different story of how integration in Western Europe occurred as the result of a number of individual decisions taken by European judges and magistrates, nameless ones, to establish the primacy of European law over national law. So it's the way that the Union really became a community of law. The other part of the story is the enlargement story and how Europe successfully enlarged eastward to bring in the post-communist states of Eastern Europe and parts of the former Soviet Union. It's another case in which the basic parameters were set by political leaders at the summit level, but the implementation was left to Brussels-based bureaucrats. So once the criteria for membership of the European Union were established, the so-called acquis communautaire, it was up to Brussels-based officials to determine whether the criteria had been met. And when later on, the French president tried to hold up Bulgarian membership, for example, he was unable to do so because he could not overcome the system that the European Union had set up for establishing who qualified for membership. So it's an interesting, different way of taking a look at the European Union. Two more cases, I'll go on very quickly. The next to last case was the NAFTA agreement, but it was written by two Mexican scholars from the Mexican perspective. And I've never seen an analysis from the Mexican side before. It's an interesting case of what are called two-level games. This is familiar in some of the political science literature. It operates especially in trade negotiations, but also in others. And the basic idea of the two-level game is that negotiations go on at the international level, obviously, but there are simultaneous negotiations going on domestically to be able to sell the deal at home. And trade negotiators, USTRs, have almost all concluded that they spent more time negotiating domestically than they did internationally. So in this case, the Salinas government hired more than a dozen lobbying firms in Washington, Texas, and California to both better understand American domestic lobbies and to influence them, and did so with the knowledge and even encouragement of the Clinton administration, because both sides knew that the other side had to have its own domestic constituencies satisfied in order for a breakthrough to take place. And the final case was on humanitarian aid to Afghanistan in the era of the Taliban. It actually is still relevant today because some of the same challenges are facing aid workers there right now. In the Taliban era, it was interesting because aid was provided by governments that didn't even have any diplomatic representation in the country. So it was a case of coordination among international organizations, NGOs, international NGOs, without the full participation of host governments who weren't, for the most part, even there. So it's an interesting story. Let me just conclude by highlighting the lessons learned. And we tried to be very scrupulous at letting the cases tell their own story rather than impose our own conclusions on them. But here are the 10 lessons we drew. I've already covered at least half of them, so I can go over them pretty quickly. First, success follows failure. In every one of these cases, failure preceded success. It's not surprising. These are hard cases, hard things to resolve. And the able diplomat, the able statesman, is able to acknowledge failure, which is hard enough, to change course, to try again, and to have the perseverance to believe that course that he or she has embarked on is the right course. It just requires more experimentation to find the right way forward. So again, you think of today's Iran negotiations. I just learned from a speech by Wendy Sherman a couple of weeks ago that the U.S. was doing secret negotiations with Iran for 2 years during the Ahmadinejad presidency. Mm-hmm. No progress to speak of. But there was learning going on. So it requires this kind of persistence and perseverance to eventually get success. Second lesson, procrastination can pay off. I think everybody who's worked in any organization has learned that. It's funny how the inbox can somehow solve itself. If you just procrastinate long enough, some of these problems go away. It really goes to the critical importance of timing in diplomatic activity. In the 24-hour news cycle, the pressure on political leaders to act immediately and decisively is enormous. Often, finding a way to slow the process down gives time for a better examination of the alternatives, to slow the public opinion down to where it's a little more manageable, and to give the other side to do likewise. I'll just give an example outside of diplomacy. There's a big issue at Princeton, where I've been teaching this year, over the name Woodrow Wilson and, you know, some racist policies associated with Wilson. Students in the Black Lives Matter movement occupied the president's office. What did he do? He formed a committee to study the problem. Now, it's a pretty boring conclusion, but it's not a bad idea to just let people's tempers just settle down long enough for some sort of deliberative process to go on. The first President Bush did this with Gorbachev. Rather than rush to find some sort of agreement with the Soviet leader, we just put things on hold and waited until we developed our own initiatives. The third lesson is successful diplomacy needs strategic planning and preparation, but also the ability to revise and adapt. I've already mentioned that. Eisenhower famously said, plans are nothing, planning is everything. It's not that plans are really nothing, but plans never go according to plan. They're the starting point for embarking on a journey, but reality always intrudes, and statesmen need to have enough confidence to be able to abandon a course and move on to it. You think of the, I don't want to get too political here, the heedless invasion and occupation of Iraq. It took 2 years before the administration could even accept what was staring, Barbara knows the story better than I, could even accept what was staring them in the face, failure. And at least acknowledging failure was the beginning of trying to find a way out. There's a case that I was involved in at the end of the Cold War. In 2 weeks, I've actually got the two strategy documents right here, they're now declassified. November 20th, 1989, 10 days after the fall of the Berlin Wall, we submitted to the president a 10-page strategy paper toward German unification. It was pretty good, I thought. I would say that, wouldn't I? And it said that under conditions of opposition from the Soviet Union, but also France and Britain, the best course is to have a gradual step-by-step process that would allow the various parties to come to terms with the process. Within a month, that carefully worked out plan was totally overtaken by events because the East German state basically imploded after the breach of the Berlin Wall. It was chaos. Unification was now coming, not gradually and step by step, but much faster. So, in late January, after a number of meetings with the President and the National Security Advisor, and similar meetings with Secretary Baker and the State Department, we submitted a new plan called A Strategy for German Unification. The new plan was the faster the better. So we did a 180-degree turn because circumstances had simply changed. Number five, statesmen and diplomats need strategic delegation and close alignment of principals and agents. Sounds obvious, but it's a big, complicated government, and to actually align the relevant parts of an administration behind a program of action requires enormous effort and enormous skill, enormous knowledge of the machinery of government. It suggests maybe we should keep electing people that know nothing about Washington, but that's another story. But these were cases. In these cases, this actually did occur. A subset of that is lesson number six. Technical experts play an increasing role in diplomacy compared to even a quarter century ago. And aligning technical experts with the political agenda of the top leadership is an increasingly important and difficult issue. We can get into that. This is part of the whole story of the growing centralization of foreign policy decision making around presidents, prime ministers, and chancellors rather than foreign ministers and secretaries of state. Number seven, statesmen need to play two-level games. I already covered that. And it's, again, not only in cases of trade negotiations. Two-level games are going on right now between the United States and Iran and many other countries. Number eight, diplomacy requires a careful mix of secrecy and openness. I already touched on this. Now, secrecy can be taken to an extreme, as the Nixon administration did. Secrecy became a compulsion to that administration, and it cost them dearly. So in a democratic society, our public demands and should have an accountable government. At some point, things need to be open. But for negotiations on sensitive matters to succeed, some degree of secrecy is required. Private negotiations. The term I use, borrowing from Woodrow Wilson, is open covenants secretly arrived at. Ninth, and this is the most important one of all, and the hardest for the American public at least. Successful diplomacy is about compromise, not victory. Everyone needs to win. I've been commenting on the Iran nuclear deal, as I'm sure some of you have. The idea that Iran should not get anything out of the deal just makes no sense. Why would they sign an agreement if they don't get something out of it? We should, and here's the even harder part, and I've been saying this publicly. We should not only give them something because we have to seal the deal, we should want them to get something out of the deal. Because otherwise, the deal won't hold up. Both sides have to see in their own self-interest that this deal was a successful one. So I'm hoping the American public will come to that understanding. And the final lesson is history doesn't repeat itself. But historical sensibility helps. If history served up clear lessons, we would have learned them a long time ago. It's really having historic sensibility of knowing how an understanding of history of past cases that have some bearing on the present can help current day diplomats. And we hope that this book has made a small contribution toward that end.
Thank you very much. You almost don't need to read the book. You just got the Cliff Note version. And I will say, as somebody who was a practitioner most of her life and has, I guess, been an academic for the last 10 years or so, it is, I think we all know, it's a challenge just to define what diplomacy is. You kind of know the absence of it, but it's kind of hard to define the reality of it. And certainly trying to teach it to the next generation, whose political awareness sort of starts about 3 weeks before they show up for your class. Let's all be honest, you know, the world didn't exist until we were each about 20. And trying to, you know, get through to them that there is history and something to be learned from it. I found in my own case, last summer, I was trying to put together a class on negotiation and mediation on a global stage, otherwise known as diplomacy, and found that there was very little that was directly useful. There were theories on negotiation. There are people who have made a life study of it, but they tended to be very removed from the reality and what Phil Zelikow talks about is just the chaos and confusion of actual diplomacy and actual politics. You have the memoirs out there, and one person once said that no one ever wrote an unflattering memoir, or at least didn't think they were. It's trying to get that middle range where you've got the major dynamics, the major epics, the major events, but done in such a way that you understand how it happened without it just becoming a People magazine story. There was one on the Iran talks that had to do with Nespressos and whiteboards, which was actually pretty good, but not terribly useful. And then I discovered, you know, I was asked to very nicely send me a copy of your book, and I read it and kind of went, aha, I finally found my book. Your use of case studies to illustrate the various elements of diplomacy, the two-level game, I think, is a critical one. The use of secrecy. It's a very well sorted out number of case studies, and that's hard to do, even among the successes. I will say that one of the things that I found particularly useful to people who either, I know many, most of the people in this room are practitioners, to go back and find out what it is you've been doing your whole life in an intelligent and articulate way. Are those of us who have moved over to the academic world and are trying to teach it to other people. It's not just these case studies. They're superb, they're well chosen, But I would say that, you know, the introduction and the conclusions, which really get into what is diplomacy, not just its nitty-gritty implementation and not just its, you know, stratospheric policy making, but that actual process, it's one of the very best that I've read. And there's one part, you didn't have it, I was wondering if it was going to show up in your top 10. One element of diplomacy that I thought was particularly good, and I'd really like you to kind of explain it and expand on it a little bit, because you were talking about what are some of the goals and tools. You said to broaden the range of policy options and opportunities beyond military force. Quote, it rescues an element of choice from the pressures of circumstance. And as I read that, and my students are probably actually getting tired of hearing me use it, it really, to me, defines what you have in your case studies. And what you're talking about is that the real job is to try to find, from the failure, the success, the two levels to use, to present the high-level policymaker with some option other than the 82nd Airborne. And I'd like you to expand on that, because I think it really does get to what statecraft is as opposed to tradecraft.
Well, the quote, I should say, comes from Henry Kissinger. We stole it from him. I'm sure you did get him credit in the book, but it's a nice line. And,
it's still a good line.
It sort of goes to this issue of structure and agency. Political leaders are confronted with situations that, by the time they get to the president's desk, are already, if they could have been reconciled, they would have been resolved at lower levels. They're really hard issues. The default position for the American public, at least, has increasingly become the military option. The first words that were uttered after Russian incursion in Ukraine was, "Are we going to intervene?" Intervene in Ukraine? Are you nuts? I mean, really the last thing on my mind, it's not feasible. It makes no sense in Russia's backyard. We can only do so at horrific cost to ourselves. So it was to the lack of imagination to imagine that there's other ways of confronting this problem. So it goes to presenting the president with the widest range of options short of the use of military force to achieve national goals. So I spent 3.5 years at the NSC staff, and my job, I thought my primary job was to present, not to think of all of myself, but to present to the president the best possible options for his consideration. That wherever they came from in the bureaucracy, that our job at the NSC was to be part of a process that yielded such options for the president, and then vet them as best we could so that some of the work was done for him. We list the pros and cons and help him in that regard.
I was willing to give you full credit for that quote, so I'm still giving you full credit for the quote. If nothing else, I think bringing it forward into a book that is going to be used far more, you get full credit for that. I think another couple of things that came out was this idea of the role of, it's a little bit into your policy options and opportunities, but the question of how you know, modify the material order, the political, the economic, the social order, in order to kind of create some of these opportunities. And if you could use some examples on how you can, to use a military term, shape the battlefield, shape the diplomatic battlefield, so that the leadership have options, have opportunities that they can choose from. And some examples on how that's been done well.
Yeah, I think the case that I'm most familiar with was the case of German unification, when we started off with really the only relevant country besides West Germany that supported unification was the United States. And we had fierce opposition from the Soviet Union, almost hysterical, but also collusion among President Mitterrand, Prime Minister Thatcher, and Gorbachev. There was a circuitous answer. The Gorbachev Foundation in Moscow, some years ago, released a transcript of a conversation between Thatcher and Gorbachev, in which Thatcher said, Britain and Western Europe are not interested in, that's almost verbatim, not interested in German unification. The words in the NATO communique may sound different, but ignore them. This is what was going on between our closest ally and our biggest adversary at the expense of our other close ally, West Germany. So that was the situation. We concluded that the best thing we could do was to foreclose the options for mischief. And we used what in the negotiated literature is called salami tactics. Mm-hmm. We sort of sliced them off one at a time. We knew the British and French couldn't hold out very long on such a position. And frankly, it was really Thatcher more than the British government writ large. And even the French got over it pretty soon. Mm-hmm. But we rallied NATO, and the West Germans, with our help, rallied the European Union around a set of principles to guide relations between the two German states. Not anticipating, not predicting, but not foreclosing German unification along the way. Once those principles were established, it was really hard for the British and the French to continue this course of obstructing the process of unification. We waited till the very end. We didn't want to ask the Soviet Union whether it approved of German unification or not, because we already knew the answer to that. So we wanted to have a series of steps taken that made it harder and harder for Moscow to resist. Every week, at least every month, some new event took place that simply pushed the process farther and farther down toward unification, making it harder and harder for Moscow to resist. At one point, I wrote in a memo for the president that if there's going to be a skunk at the 2+4 picnic, it'll have to be Moscow. 2+4 was a negotiating framework for doing unification. So, and we worked with the Soviet side to say, do you really want to poison your relationship with United Germany for a generation in this effort to somehow block unification? Once they had come around to the within a few months, they'd come around to accept the inevitability of unification, but they still resisted the United Germany's being a member of NATO. This was too much for them to take. So we worked on them there, too. We got everybody else to agree that Germany should be in NATO, if that's what its duly elected representative government wanted to do. And we found ways at various levels to say to the Soviet side, can you imagine what Europe looks like with Germany out of NATO? Do you really want to see the German general staff reconstituted? You know, that of course conjures up some not too distant memories in Soviet thinking. So it was all these things. We tried to develop a strategy that made it harder for the Soviet side to say nyet and easier for it to say da. And by the summer, by late spring of 1990, 7-8 months after the breach of the Berlin Wall, their options had narrowed considerably. There was really, except at enormous cost, there was not much they could do to block unification.
Yeah, well, that's a wonderful example. I know that when I'm working with students, either talking about diplomacy as a career or in the classroom, one of the questions that often comes up, and it reflects the wonderful idealism of our students. But I think it's also an unfortunate shadow coming from the previous administration, where we sought to have purity of partners. That we wouldn't talk with people who, if we didn't like their policies, we didn't like their governments. And at least those of us who were practicing diplomats at the time, in to a certain extent, found that the number of people we were allowed to say hello to at national days was constricting on us. Other people have said that you don't negotiate with your friends, you negotiate with your enemies. How, either in your studies, your own personal background, or as an academic in dealing with students, how do you answer this question on the purity of partners issue?
I think we need to be able to talk to anybody. You think of the price we're paying now, the price we're paying for not having had diplomatic relations with Iran, because we don't approve them. We don't approve them. but we should still be there because we have to rely on other countries' intelligence to know some rudimentary things about this country. If we were there, we'd be better informed. Same thing with Cuba, although the price is maybe not as high, but we should have been there all these years. Breaking relations with the Bolshevik regime and not resuming them until 1933 meant that we had no regular dialogue with the Soviet Union during a pivotal time in European affairs. Not having relations with the Chinese made it that much harder for Nixon and Kissinger to achieve the breakthrough. They might have missed the opportunity. You know, they might have run out of time because it was so hard to establish a dialogue when you don't have diplomatic relations. So I think that's one thing we should learn. You know, you think the Iran nuclear deal, the fact that secret talks went on with the Ahmadinejad presidency was one of the essential preconditions for getting as far as we've gotten. It's interesting, had that regime wanted to, it could have embarrassed Obama pretty badly by exposing the fact of this. But they too saw some need for talking to the great Satan because they had something they wanted to get out of this deal.
Thinking of talking to purity of partners, they put that aside on our benefit. Yeah.
And you know, there's another issue. Maybe I should have used the word because to me the most important single quality of a diplomat is empathy, which is not the same as sympathy. Sympathy means you understand. You take great pains to understand where the other side is coming from. If you're trying to alter their behavior or adjust their behavior in ways that are congenial to your own interests, you need to understand that side first. And the level of understanding requires a diplomatic presence. It requires reports officers out there helping us understand what's going on in another country.
Having had to deal with a number of rather unpeer partners, I actually agree. I want to kind of get down to, I think, you know, how this book can be used, how case studies can be used, what's the purpose of it, and I will, a small commercial aside, the Institute for the Study of Diplomacy does have 230 case studies, and we've just got a major grant to significantly update. You mentioned in your book that our case study library had gotten a little
replenished.
They had not been replenished recently. That's diplomats. I had not been replenished recently. Well, we're about to replenish. And certainly your book will be, I think, part of this. We have somebody from FSI here who is working on the training of diplomats. AFSA, of course, is dedicated to, you know, the profession, which includes the training, the education, the professionalism of our corps. And it's certainly what you and I have been doing in the academic world. What are some of the things that all of us should be looking at in how do we prepare, educate, foster the right kind of diplomats going forward? Using our case studies, using the lessons, how do we get ourselves ready for the 21st century?
I really salute you for taking on the case studies because I've used them in class myself and I'm really glad to see going online. I still use them, but I'd like, you know, some
we're getting new ones. Great.
Here, I might just say, the problem here is not just the Institute for the Study of Diplomacy or Pew. The problem is the academic community, because young scholars don't get tenure on the basis of writing case studies, unless you really work with them. They get their tenure, get on track for tenure by writing in peer-reviewed professional journals, most of which have gotten more and more theoretical over time and less relevant. I think there's a kind of a move back. This book is a part of this. I think there's a move back on the part of many in the academic community realize we've gotten too out in theoretical la-la land to be relevant to anybody.
Quantitative as well.
Yeah. So it's not only case studies, though. There's lots of other things that ought to be resurrected for study. I'm just launching a new book on strategy and statecraft. It's going to be a big undertaking because, as you said earlier, there really is not much of a literature out there. Scholars have not been helping the diplomatic community by producing a corpus of work that would really be good. There's some good literature on negotiation, you mentioned it, a little bit on mediation, some good stuff on decision-making, but not on the rest of it. There's not a single really good book on policy planning, for example. And just taking it from a different angle, I've done been back in Washington for a while now, and I'm getting, sort of making the rounds and reacquainting myself, and I've been struck at how much has changed just in the interval since I was last in and around this town. The NSC has gotten huge. So the NSC no longer plays the role that I just thought was the way it was always supposed to be played, small, overworked, but small staff that didn't have time to get into everybody's issue. Most of those issues belonged to the Department of State or somewhere else, but it was the one place where you could think, you had to think, the big synthetic issues. Policy planning is just overwhelmed, the State Department is just overwhelmed with current stuff. There's very little, not only very little time, there's very little appetite for strategic planning there. I used to chair the National Intelligence Council. That too used to be a repository for strategic thinking. It sometimes was ignored. It usually was ignored. But at least there was a place where somebody was thinking big strategic ideas that policymakers might avail themselves. So if the NSC is not doing it, the NIC is not doing it, the Policy Planning Department of the State is not doing it, who is? And I think that's the subject for concern by scholars who ought to be examining this, and by practitioners who ought to be thinking, how do we get back to a way where we can do better strategic planning?
Yeah, I kind of sort of following on that, because I, again, sort of having been in the academic world for a while, and sometimes looking around for the kinds of books, one of the two things that I think of as trends in the academic world, and I'd like to hear your views on how you think this affects our ability to create the kind of policy thinkers, as well as policy doers, that we need, is both the withering away of diplomatic history as an academic subject, and if you can't see backwards, it's hard to see forwards. If you don't know what happened 20 years ago, you can't even think about 5 years ago. You're starting to look right now, and also the withering away of area studies. That my sense is that with those two academic disciplines and focuses, not having the same academic salience as quantitative analysis and some theory, is that we're producing the people who would be going into intelligence, into diplomacy, into policy thinking, who lack that, both that context and that empathy to be able to really shape policy and kind of address some of your 10 lessons. I know you've been there too. So
those are great questions, and I think maybe part of it is doing a little reflecting about who we are as people. How we are different. We think of ourselves as the normal country, and every other country is something different. But we tend to be very ahistorical because of our history. We don't look back, we look forward, we're innovative, we're creative, we're thinking about things. We instinctively don't pay as much of attention to history as most other countries do. Some countries never get past history, the Balkans come to mind.
Yeah.
But then you think about when presidents are asked what they're reading, it's either biography or history, almost always. Mm-hmm. That's where they look. They're looking backwards to find some place in the history, either in the distant past or the recent past, that gives them some clue as to how to act now. So I think recovering historical sensibility, to use that word again. Eisenhower was not a great student. He was low in his class at West Point. He wasn't a great intellect. He wasn't a great reader of history, but he had a historic sensibility. He knew that this mattered, and he would instinctively try to capture this. And area studies, I know I'm a product of an area studies program myself, and area studies have, no matter how you slice the pie, you lose something. So area studies had some weaknesses, but diplomacy plays out in specific contexts. Mm-hmm. So you need to know both the general skills that go into diplomacy, but also how to apply them in a specific context. That means you need to have knowledge of the country, the history, the culture, the novels, the language, all that stuff. And I advise my students that they should have one region that they're pretty good at. They're focusing on, they're taking a lot of coursework on it. And they ought to have a little bit of familiarity with the second regions. so they have maybe not expert knowledge, but our knowledge is. Knowing that, at least I found in my own career, I knew a lot about Eastern Europe. I knew way more than I should have known about Eastern Europe. But I found that at least when I went to an area where I didn't know something, I knew what I didn't know. Yeah, I knew that there was things I needed to know that I needed to find out. You think of the authors of the Iraq policy, it wasn't, you know this.
Yeah.
I was thinking of some of the people at the NSC doing Iraq at the time of the invasion and occupation. They not only didn't know anything about the region, they didn't think it important to know anything about the region. That was the real tragedy.
Well, I just on a, to, as a footnote to that, yes, I was involved in the Iraq thing, and I, but I unwillingly. But I remember one time talking with a senior person over at DOD who shall remain nameless, and trying to get some basic Iraqi history into their calculation. And I was told, verbatim, we are smarter than history. And so, and at that point, I knew Iraq was a failure, and this is before we'd even gotten there. But this idea that history didn't matter, that somehow we were smarter, that our exceptionalism made all of the rules of history irrelevant. At least we have empirical evidence as to what happens when you try that. And I would like to second, your what you said about being a regional studies. I was a regional studies specialist too, not in the region that I spent my career. And I tell students the same thing for the same reason, that having learned that in order to understand Asia, I had to do the history, the religion, the novels, the fairy tales, I will tell people, all of that, that when I got moved to another region, I knew what I had to go look for. And so that regional studies gives you intellectual skills well beyond the actual data that you know about the history of Eastern Europe in the 17th century. And so I think that is a major failing that we have in our preparation for good global citizens in general, and particularly for diplomats, intelligence, and all of those who are involved in the policy world. Do you see from your vantage point at U Texas any shift in this beyond your own personal effort?
Or regional studies are still, I don't think they've made a comeback yet.
Yeah.
I think diplomatic history has made a comeback. And so I think I'm a little more encouraged there. When I first left government and went to Princeton in 1997, Princeton didn't have a single diplomatic historian. It's just Princeton University. Not one diplomatic historian. It was because the profession had moved over into social history and other things, and you simply didn't get, you didn't earn your spurs by doing diplomatic history. That has changed. You can now, prosper as a diplomatic historian. So this is a little bit, not exactly direct to your question, but this book I'm working on now, I'm sort of doing some small dives into historical episodes, those that seem to be most fruitful for understanding diplomacy today. And one of them was up at Princeton, the John Foster Dulles papers are in the manuscript library. And I went to read the all the papers that were associated with the Solarium project in the Eisenhower administration. So 3 months into his presidency, Eisenhower, having inherited a Cold War footing from Harry Truman, decided to want to explore his options to make sure that there wasn't a better course of action that he could take. So he commissioned three teams, Team A, Team B, Team C. George Kennan led Team A, along with a group of six others on the team. And there was equally robust Teams B and C. Eisenhower gave them the three scenarios they were to examine. Kennan was to examine containment. Team B was to examine, basically drawing a line in Europe and saying, consolidating the Western Alliance, telling the Soviet Union, any transgression across that line is World War III. And by implication, whatever you do on the other side of the line is none of our business. And then Team C was to, it was basically a soft rollback. It was destabilization measures in the East. So it's the kind of thing that an awareness of that episode, just interesting for present-day diplomats to think about. You wouldn't replicate the thing exactly, but it's a model that can increase the options, at least explore the options.
I'd like to open it to questions and comments. This is a very well-experienced group. I'd like to hear from, I know Bob would like to hear from you as well, your reactions or your questions.